Yeah, this is kind of middle of the road. 2000 was a daydream. It was brilliant. There were whole asset classes. Bonds were cheap. And TIPS had just come out, inflation-protected bonds. And they, get this, they yielded 4.3 real, guaranteed, protected against inflation and guaranteed by the U.S. government, 4.3%. REITs yielded 9.1, right at the top of the market with the S&P yielding 1.6, which was the lowest in history. What a wonderful comparison. Incidentally, people said, yeah, but they grow much faster. And we said, you know, click, next exhibit. Yes, you're absolutely right. The long-term growth of the dividend stream of the REITs is precisely 1.0% a year less than the S&P. And for that, you get an extra 7 points cash yield. I mean, give me a break, 7.5. That was heaven. And 07 was not as anywhere near an early 08, not nearly as overpriced a market as 2000, as the tech bubble. But it was damn near universal. I had a quarterly letter, which started from the junkiest bonds to the greatest blue chip, from land in Mayfair to downtown Tokyo, et cetera, et cetera. It's bubble time. And it was everywhere. And that made life difficult. 2000, you know, being the perfect one, real estate was pretty cheap, a whole asset class. And small cap value was brilliant. And REITs were up 30 when the S&P was minus 50 right at the bottom, just to pay you back for your patience. And we made money. In a global diversified portfolio, we made money in 2000, in 2001. And even by the skin of our nose in 2002, when the S&P was down 22%. So that was perfect. 07 was the most slippery one. To make money there, you had to get into the anti-risk bet. The classic anti-risk bet was long yen, short sterling. The opposite of the bet that everyone had been riding as a free lunch for several years. And it, of course, blew back in the opposite direction, with a 20% gain on both sides of the trade in 3 months. So it was like a license to steal there as the market created. But you had to do exotic things. It was not easy. This one is in between. This one, the whole of the emerging market is a little bit cheap on a relative basis. Sensational. In the housing bubble, emerging was higher priced than the S&P 500 on a PE basis. It had had the most amazingly successful run that we played and played and played, probably with hindsight, overstayed our welcome, so that we, for once, were jumping after the peak instead of, you know, 2 years too soon. Anyway, back to today, even the rest of the world, equity markets are not too bad, which points out this interesting argument about low interest rates. The argument goes, low interest rates give us no choice. That's why the market's so high. That's why it's actually cheap. To which we say, oh, wait a second. What are the rates in the rest of the developed world? Whoops, they're a bit lower than the US and have been for a couple of years or so. And the PEs are much cheaper. So it casts a doubt on the sufficiency of that reason. I wouldn't say the developed world ex-US is cheap, but it's not bad. It's a little bit expensive, perhaps, absolutely very cheap on a relative basis to the US. But emerging is a bit better than that. And then you have the kind of low growth or value end versus the high growth. And I don't think that low growth or value is a license to steal, which it was for basically 100 years until 2000. I do think some of the dynamics of growth versus low growth has shifted, but still the parameter is so massively depressed against low growth in favor of high growth that you know it will usher in a period of several years of movement in the opposite direction, which should be good for tens of points of outperformance, perhaps 30, 40, 50 points, I would guess. If you can add those two together, so if you go into the low growth end of emerging, you might, it's not only you might, you almost certainly will do perfectly well over 10 or 20 years. The question would be, when the US blows, will it take emerging with it? And I suspect, you know, history says, yes, it will, but let me remind you of 2002. In 2002, the S&P went down 22%, as I said, but emerging went down 2%. And that's a pretty handsome difference. Emerging had already become cheap. Cheap really matters. It's not just beta. You know, you can have stocks that typically go up and down 1.5 times as much as the blue chips, like small cap. But small cap was so cheap in 2000, you pretty well knew it would outperform, and it did. And small cap value was just about break even when the S&P was down 50, even though it had a high beta because it was so sensationally cheap. It's not so sensationally cheap today, but low growth value is. And so that's the play. Avoid the US, avoid the high growth. And there are some decent opportunities. Of course, however, unlike 2000, debt is ruinously expensive. And, you know, in the long bond back in 82, my colleague Dick Mayo was making a personal killing, put all his money into 30-year US treasuries on 90% leverage and took a deep breath. You know, could have been wiped out, but it was a really heroic bet. And the 16% yields very quickly became 13, and the cost of carry, you know, became 10, 11, and suddenly you were making a 5-point spread on the 90% you borrowed, plus a 16 points on the 10% principal, plus a capital gain. Those were the days. And the 16% came down to 12 and causes a bull market, and the 12 goes to 8, causes another bull market, and the 8 goes to 4 and causes another bull market. And now it's down to rock bottom, ebbing around between 0.5% and 2%. Where do you go from there? I mean, that game, it took a long time. It was great. It's 38 years. Wow. Sorry, 32 years. That's game over. And it's a piece of cake. You lower the rates, you're going to tend to push up the price of assets, other things being even. And we've done that. Been there, done that, as they say. On the interest rate argument, I think that's pretty easy. I mean, if you're going to justify something as being cheap by picking the most overpriced asset and using that as a yardstick, you're an idiot. I mean, you might as well say, compared to Bitcoin or Tesla, the S&P is incredibly cheap. Whoopee, buy some more, go on margin. I mean, you have to use an absolute standard, and the absolute standard would be the margin adjusted Shiller PE. The Shiller PE is not enough on its own, because for 20 years, we've been in an abnormally high US profit margin era, not in the rest of the world and clearly temporary, but the share of GDP going to corporations has jumped up for a while. Has a bit to do with monopoly and short-term circumstances, and I have no doubt it will tend to move back in the opposite direction. But I'm very tempted to digress on that point, because one of the reasons we have low rates is because of the population profile. You know, you took 600 million young and middle-aged farm workers in China, whose productivity was negligible, and you moved them to the cities. And you took a couple of hundred million Eastern Europeans who weren't really plugged into the capitalist system at all, and you plugged them in. And it gave you a jolt of cheap, eager, new labor, the like of which we had never seen in history. And that kind of drove the game for 20 years. Globalization and pressure on the wages of the West, why wouldn't it be? So they made it very easy for unions to lose all their power, for corporations to rule the roost and to increase their share of profits. And the government didn't move against that. It actually changed the laws to make it even easier for corporations to increase their share of the pie. And of course, inequality went off the scale, and the measure of inequality ratio became the worst in the developed world, only outflanked by the odd Brazil. So I think that was a fairly desperate long-term consequence, which we have to live with. But now the workers in China, everyone who wanted to leave has gone, and their population has entered one of the big busts of history, and encouraged by the one-child plan, but it's pretty much echoed everywhere anyway. So Taiwan and Korea and Japan have got the same bust that they have in Japan without any draconian one-child policy. And the baby cohorts that are coming down the pipeline here are just amazing. There was one the other day from South Korea. South Korea, under the impact of COVID, dropped from its world record 1.0 fertility rate. You need 2.1 to replace your population, and they had 1.0. And then when COVID came, it went to 0.85, and being the world's most efficient government, it seems, they reported on that first already almost 2 weeks ago. And 0.85, it's just amazing. It means that every 33 years, let's say a generation, you've got less than half the babies you had before. And that's been going on, of course, in Japan. So the young men appearing for military service in Japan are down by 30% already. And in 30 years, they're about 1.5. So in 30 years, they'll be down to half of what they were at the peak. And in the US, we just came out the year before, 1.7, lowest ever recorded, just below the previous low of 1931 in the Depression. And this year, we may be down quite a bit because of COVID. We don't know, but maybe 1.6. And China is going to be below 1.6. These are not insignificant countries. This is a huge shift. It means that almost immediately, we're going to see, led by Japan and Korea and so on, we're going to see a shortage of workers. And instead of having extra hundreds of millions, we're going to have a shortage. And so it's going to put pressure on wages, finally. It's going to make equality look a little better. It's going to put some buying power in the hands of typical workers, but it's going to put pressure on prices. It's going to put pressure on inflation, and it's going to put pressure on real interest rates. And I suspect we will be moving back towards a kind of 20th century looking world with perfectly good GDP growth, maybe a little increase for 10 or 20 years on productivity of the workers, because when they're short, you get into capital spending to keep their productivity rolling. And you can't just easily displace it to China. The Chinese wages, you know, have gone up 15 times over 20 years, and they're now running out of workers themselves. So CapEx everywhere will tend to be trying to compensate. So productivity, which has been settling down steadily everywhere for the last 50 years, you know, when I got here, it was running at 3% a year, and now we'd be lucky if it was half that. And in addition, employment was rising at over 1% a year, and now we'll be lucky if it stays positive at all in the next 10 years in the US. And in Europe, it will definitely be negative. So there's a big downward pressure on GDP growth, but there's a big shortage of labor and therefore probably a push up on productivity. And it takes us way back into the world we all grew up with, or as older people grew up with, which is a more normal return on investment, a more normal interest rate, a more normal rate of inflation. And one of the consequences to that, you will bid down the price of assets over the next 20 years, and maybe starting pretty soon. And maybe the recovery from COVID will run straight into the changes in the pressures on wages and so on. And that's a pressure on profit margins. So other things being even, that drifts back down where it came from to more normal levels of GDP. Anyway, that would be a very powerful shift and would be a major downward pressure on price earnings ratios going forward. I think it would work out pretty healthily, actually. It would mean that the new acquirers of wealth would be able to kind of get into the game. At the moment, with the return on most assets half of what it used to be, it's very hard to compound wealth. You know, if you have a 6% return on your asset, whether it's stocks or a farm or a forest or a bond, or a junk bond, I might say. If you're compounding at 6%, you know, you're doubling every 12 years. And if you're compounding at 3, which we do today, it takes 24 years. So in 48 years, you're down to a quarter. And in 96 years, you're pretty well disappeared. So it's a hell of a hard way to get rich, compounding with high asset prices and low yields on every darn asset you could think of. So drifting back is painful at one. In one way, it's painful on your portfolio price, but it's great for your compounding ability. And it's great, particularly for the young who have to get in and start acquiring assets and who can't afford a house because house prices will come down. As the population profile changes and there are fewer babies, and then 20 years later, there are fewer workers, there are fewer house buyers, and the housing stock becomes generously oversupplied as it is in Japan. And the prices of land and houses relative to GDP start to drop, which is great for the young. And you just have to be braced for it. I know this is a longer term argument than you probably are bargaining for,